Blessed unto you from God our Father and Jesus Christ our Savior. It's such honor and privilege for you to join me in this space and in this place as we do what? Embrace God's grace. This is Pastor Kay and this is your Sunday conversation. And I am so excited about this because this conversation today is something that comes up quite frequently within our congregation and our churches about sin, about the law and grace. So today's lesson comes from Romans, the 7th chapter. We're going to deal with all verses 1 through 25, I'm sorry. More like we're going to deal with 1 through 12, actually, with the title, The Law Reveals Sin. I'm so glad you tuned in today. Stick around. Virtual space, but we are back and we are better than ever. And you always remember, if you can't make it in here live in the virtual office, the virtual space, then you can always go back on YouTube, you can go back during the week and watch it, or we would love to invite you into our sanctuary in person if you are in the Bowling Green area or within the next, 150 miles, hey, it's worth a little drive. Go on some John P. Key and make your way to Bowling Green, Kentucky, 340 State Street, 42101. Wow, let's get right into this today. I am so excited today because this is something that it comes up frequently. Do we obey the law? Are we still under the law? What does the law have to do with us now versus grace? And let me tell you, Romans is a book that I have studied extensively. I love it so much. It's Paul's dissertation to the church in Rome. And he's explaining to them the difference between grace and the law. So let's get right into it. Let's go to the Lord with prayer. Lord, we love you, we praise you, we bless your holy name. We want to thank you, Lord, for everything that you have done for us today. Lord, we ask that you open up our hearts, open up our minds, and get our hands to work, Lord, for you and kingdom building, Lord. And in Jesus' name we pray, amen. Amen, amen, amen. Well, I've been a law enforcement officer, not a lawmaker, but a law enforcement officer. There's a difference between the two. I don't write the law, okay? Those on Capitol Hill write the law. I enforce the law. So don't get mad at me because of the laws on the book, okay? But there's a quote that says that laws are created for the mutual benefit of society to give clear guidance for right and wrong. So the question is, why do people insist on breaking the law? That's what we're going to talk about today. Why do we insist on breaking the law? Where does this law come from? What is the purpose of the law? I know good and well there are some laws on Capitol Hill that make zero sense whatsoever. You're wondering, like, what in the world this has to do with anything? But hey, somebody wrote it. Somebody thought that it was for the right, for society, and it got passed. And now as a law enforcement officer, it has to be enforced, okay? Because it's on the books, okay? So the question is, what does this law do? What is it for? And why do we insist on breaking the law? Well, Paul is knee-deep into this dissertation to the church in Rome. And he starts off in chapter 7 and verse number 1. He says, "Do you not know, brothers and sisters, for I am speaking to those who know the law, that the law has authority over someone only as long as that person lives. For example, by law, a married woman is bound to her husband as long as he is alive. But if her husband dies, she is released from the law that binds her to him. So then, if she has sexual relations with another man while her husband is still alive, she is called an adulteress. But if her husband dies, she is released from the law and is not an adulteress if she marries another man." Let's deal with this right here. Let's deal with this. The first part of subsection underneath this Sunday school lesson of the law reveals sin is that the law has dominion. The law has dominion. And in Romans 6:14, you got to go back. In Romans 6:14, Paul told us that we are not under the law, but under grace. Let me say that one more time. Let me say that for those in the back. We are not under the law. We are under grace. And I believe that there is a confusion amongst the saints of understanding the difference between the two, okay? So after the discussion in Romans 6, 15 through 33, no, I'm sorry, 15 through 23, regarding practical implications of this, Paul then explains more completely how it is that we are no longer under the dominion of the law. So Paul explains it to us. He says, hey, this is why we're no longer underneath the law. So those that want to hold you to the law, go and have them read the book of Romans. Explain to them what Romans says when it comes to the law. He said that the law has dominion. The law has authority over a man. See, the ancient Greek wording that Paul uses has no word "the" before law. So he's not specifically saying this law. What Paul is really saying in a broader sense, outside of Mosaic law, outside of what Moses brought down to the people, is the reason why Paul does this. It's very interesting. He says, not only the Ten Commandments, not only that, but there are some other laws and rules too that I'm speaking of as well. Now, he said the law has dominion. It has authority over man, including the law of Moses. But there is a broader principle of law communicated by creation and by conscience that these also have dominion over man. Told you, we're going to talk about that for a moment. Paul breaks it down. He said the law has dominion over a man as long as he lives. Now, let me go ahead and give you the warning right now. Paul is not talking about your physical life. He's talking about your spiritual life. He's not talking about this physical, this earthly tabernacle. He is speaking about your spiritual life. That the law has dominion over you as long as you live. See, Paul makes the point that death ends all obligations and contracts. When you die, that ends the contract. That's why sometimes when you are in debt and you pass away or your loved one has passed away and that they were in debt, that debt goes away. You're no longer bound to that contract unless you have a co-signer. But if you don't have a co-signer and it's just your debt, guess what? When you die, it's null and void. They can't collect on it. They can't sue nobody else for it. They can't do any of that. That is now null and void. So what Paul says is a wife is no longer bound to her husband if he dies because death ends that contract. So two people are married. And that is a covenant. That is a vow between the two of them. Guess what? When the husband dies, she's no longer obligated to him. Now, while he's still alive, she is. So if a husband dies, she is free from the law. A marriage covenant was no longer binding after the death of a spouse. So similarly, this is what Paul is getting to. He uses this as an example. One is no longer bound to the law once he or she participates in the death and resurrection of Christ. Once you have died to your sin, to your flesh, to this world, you're no longer under the contract. You're no longer bound to the law anymore. You catch that? That's why baptism is so important. Baptism shows the death and the resurrection of an individual. So when you die, you're no longer underneath that law. You're no longer underneath the law. You're no longer under the covenant anymore. So in Christ, we have died to our obligation to uphold the law. Meaning we no longer have to uphold the law. Now, this is not to degenerate the law's goodness, because the law has its purpose and its place. But Paul tackles the relationship and debate the necessity of putting ourselves in bondage by trying to uphold the law. We put ourselves in bondage trying to uphold the law, y'all. We put more on us trying to uphold the law. We can't do it anyway. So the laws are shackles that bind believers as slaves rather than servants. So if you have professed a hope in Christ and you are still trying to go off of the law, you're not being a servant, you're being a slave. That's what you're doing. We as Christians have been freed, released, and liberated from the law of Moses. You know the case. Take a little walk with me for a moment. If that was the case, once accepting Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior, then why you don't see people bringing animals to the church to sacrifice on the altar? That's the Mosaic law. Your sins have to be put on an animal, and that animal is slain. Paul tells us, for the wages of sin is death, right? So because you have sinned, something has to die. So you imputed your sins upon this animal, and the animal is slain. So if we're still underneath the law, that means we'll still be sacrificing animals at the altar. But, getting ahead of myself, but who is the great and last sacrifice? Jesus the Christ. See, as kingdoms, as citizens of the kingdom, the law holds on us has been alleviated. We don't have to go by those rules anymore. For example, let me give you another example. Anybody in the military that's watching today, just go in the comment section and say, hey, I'm watching. In the United States, we have a speed limit on our interstate system. But once you leave the United States and you go to Germany, they have the Autobahn. Go 75 miles an hour on that Autobahn if you want to. You'll get hit and they'll keep on going. Because they go at an extremely fast rate and it's designed for you to go at a fast rate. You can't go 75 miles on that thing, you gotta go faster than that. But guess what? That's in another place and another kingdom. So guess what? You follow that rule. So we no longer have to follow the law because we're no longer in the worldly kingdom. We're in God's kingdom. And just like in chapter 6, we are told of our release from the slavery of sin. Those who are in Christ have been released from the slavery of law. Not only from sin, but from the law as well. Now, let me give you a little side order of scripture if you don't mind. Galatians 3:11. And it says, so it is clear that no one can be made right with God by trying to keep the law. For the scripture says, it is through faith that a righteous person has life. Even if you want to practice, it's hard for me to say this, but let me just say this theologically incorrect, okay? I'm going to make an exegetical fallacy here. If you have professed the hope in Christ and you still trying to uphold the law, guess what? You're still going to be able to do it. Nobody can keep the law. Only one person kept the law perfect. You couldn't even keep the law. See, death frees us from the law. When we die, we were free from the law because you're no longer under the contract, right? And then when you come back up, you're a brand new person. That means that old man, that old contract, hey, you don't have to follow it anymore. So see, here's the thing. Paul knew that the Roman church that he's writing to was comprised of Jewish and Roman Christians. So you have a mixture of them. The Jews who have been schooled, they've been taught, trained from birth, y'all, about the Jewish law. Without question, adept at regurgitating and expounding upon its contents. I mean, they could take the law up and down because that was part of their curriculum from knee-high to a grasshopper on up. They knew the law. So Jesus knew the law too. That's why he said, you've been told, but I say unto you. He knows the word because he is the word, but he was trained just like any other Jewish boy as well. See, the law represented who they were. But see, the Gentiles, unlike the Jews, were not owners of the law, but have been well versed in it as well. How do I explain this? I'm trying to explain this in a way which I know that it will reach across the board and everyone will understand it. Okay, let me give it this way. You have been adopted and you come into this family. Now, this is not your real dad, it's not your real mother, and this is not your blood brother or blood sister. They call you stepchild, but guess what? You learn everything about the family, although you are not biologically a part of this family. That's what it is to be a Gentile. Gentiles come into the picture, and they're not the children of God. They're not from Abraham. But they know everything about Abraham, they know everything about Isaac, they know everything about Jacob, they know everything about Moses. Why? Because the Jews made sure they knew it. As a matter of fact, you have some people in the church called Judaizers. And what the Judaizers were, Deacon Jackson, that those who adopted Jewish religious practices or sought to influence others to do so. Let me explain to you this way how they did it. A Judaizer is someone who's who come and influence you at upholding the Jewish law. Although you're a Gentile, they're making you do Jewish customs and courtesies, like the dietary restrictions, or obeying the law of Moses, or circumcision, right? When it was not required because it wasn't given to us. When you try to make somebody go off of the Jewish law, you are a Judaizer. And unfortunately, you got a lot of Gentiles trying to make other Gentiles follow Jewish custom and courtesy. Make that make sense. That mouth is not mouthing. But that's exactly what they try to do. See, we are under grace as a Gentile. And that's what Paul's whole letter is about. We are under grace. If you're not Jewish, if you're a male child, you have not been, if you haven't had a bar mitzvah and all the other things that comes with being an individual of the Jewish descent or the Jewish custom and courtesy or lifestyle, then you're a Gentile. If you're not Jewish, you're a Gentile. That's it. That's the easiest way for me to explain it. And we are under grace and not the law. Under the regime of the Old Testament, the law was a burden before the gospel came into being. It was hard to keep the laws. I'll tell you why in a minute. It was hard to keep these laws. I mean, think about it. 613 laws? I think that was it. 613 laws. You had to follow. You had to follow 613 of these laws. It was hard for you to do. And the thing that gets to me is the fact that we put burdens on individuals in the church as well. We've been free from the law, but then we try to put burdens on other people when they come into the church. You got to shout this way, you got to sing this way, you got to preach this way, you got to look this way, you got to smell this way, you got to dress this way. You can't do this, you can't do that. We just put burdens on people when Christ has freed us from those things. Why are we so into doing that? But then it goes to the next subsection where Paul says, I need for you to understand as a believer, as a child of God, as a Christian, right? You are dead to the law. We just talked about death, did we not? We are dead to the law. That we don't have to follow the law because we've died. And we're not under it anymore. Verse number 4, this is what Paul says. He says, therefore, my brethren, you also have become dead to the law through the body of Christ, that you may be married to another, to him who was raised from the dead, that we should bear fruit to God. For when we were in the flesh, the sinful passions which were aroused by the law were at work in our members to bear fruit to God. Death. But now we have been delivered from the law, having died to what we were held by, so that we should serve in the newness of the spirit and not in the oldness of the letter. Can't get any more clearer than that. I didn't say that. Paul did. Paul says, hey, you've been delivered from the law. You don't have to follow the law anymore. You've been delivered from it. You're not held by it anymore. Now you understand that scripture says that at the end of the day, that there will come a day where every knee must bow and every tongue must confess that Jesus Christ is the Lord. He's the Son of God. God ain't going to have a checklist that says, okay, let's see, rule number 238 you broke. No. That's why he sent his son. That's why he sent his son for us. See, what we have to understand is that in Romans 6, 3, verses 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, and 8, Paul carefully explained that we died with Jesus and we also rose with him. Dead, Now we're alive again, right? And although he only spoke of death to sin, Paul now explains that we also died to the law. See, we as believers are dead to the law as far as it represents a principle of living or a place of right standing before God. We are through with the law. Once we died and we became new, we shout about becoming new. My hands look new and my feet dead too. We got that song, right? Yeah, we got that damn fact. Well, guess what? When that happened, we are done with the law. It is not for us an option as a way of salvation. We don't have to keep the laws of heaven now. So if somebody want to put a burden on you, try to make you go by the law, whatever. Nope. You're done with it. It was taken care of one Friday on a hill called Calvary. Well, you know how my favorite saying goes, where they hung him high and they stretched him wide. He died. Didn't he die? So glad he died. But early, that Sunday morning. It's pretty good. He got up with all power in his hands. We're not under the law anymore. We're not. We're done with it. We do not seek to be right with God by obeying some form of the law. It's not by your works you've been saved, but it's by grace you have been saved. Because somebody could be able to brag and say, how many laws you keep today? I kept 100 of them. Oh, I kept 150 of them. I'm better than you. Nope. And that's what's in God's plan, to keep us from doing that. But it's like the law is no good now. Most religions try to keep you under the law. Do this, do that, do this, do that. Can't do that, can't say that, can't enjoy that, can't participate in that. God, half the laws that we put on people now, I think God sit back and laugh at. Like, I never said that. I guarantee you that's what God is doing. I guarantee you he's looking at me saying, I never said that. So, in the marriage context, Paul begins with that we are not free from the law so we can live unto ourselves. So, God didn't release us from the law so we can do whatever the heck we want to do. We are free so we can be married to Jesus and so that we can bear fruit to God, not fruit to death. That's why he freed us from the law. The law is leading us to death. But the law, the grace can lead us to producing fruit for God. Let's keep talking about it for a moment. See, the marriage bond is broken through death. And so also is the Christian's connection to the law broken through death. The worldly death of Christians breaks the formal bond of the law and yokes them with Christ. Attaches you to Christ. Puts you side by side with Christ. And as a result, God has freed you from the world, but you should be bonded with the Savior. So if you're not doing things that the Savior would do, then we have a problem. Because you're supposed to be Christ-like. So that's why Jesus said that those that were not treating the poor, the sick, the homeless, the the low income, the majority and marginalized individuals, when you don't treat them right, Jesus says, hey, you're doing the same thing to me. I was naked and you didn't give me no clothes. I was hungry and you didn't feed me. I was in prison and you didn't come see me. Sure didn't. And when you do this to them, you're doing it to me as well, because we are bonded. We are yoked together. So what you do to one of these, you're doing it to me. So upon the death of Christians, all prior relationships become null and void. When we die to our old man, all relationships become null and void. We got some people, though, that like to still go back under that old contract. Why? You've been free. That's stupid. I say it was stupid. It makes zero sense, y'all. It's like, imagine how our ancestors being freed from slavery and then turn around and go right back. Talking about, I still want to be a slave. I still want to be mistreated. I still want to be whipped. I still want to be abused. I still want to be talked about. I still want to be demasculated. I still want to be separated from my family. I still don't want to get paid for my work. Imagine that. You would probably say, that's silly. That makes it, and that's the exact same thing Paul is saying right here. That when you are free, you are free. The new union, the new marriage, when Jesus fosters growth and enhances the production of an abundance fruit. Now let the works I've done speak for me. It doesn't make sense now. The relationship that was once based on the law was ineffective in bearing the fruit of righteousness. You couldn't do it. The old man has died and is now made new through the body of Christ. You're a new person. You're a new creation. You are a new human being. All things are passed away. That's why Paul continues to write on this subject in the book of Romans, where he says, renew within me, not renew within me. He says, be transformed by the renewing of your mind. You know, present your body as a living sacrifice. Sacrifice is to die, which is holy and accepted unto God. Be not conformed to this world, but what? Through Christ be renewed, be transformed, become something new. So you gotta become something new. See, when we were all under the flesh, under the law, we did not bear fruit to God. Instead, we bore fruit to death. Because the law aroused the passions of sin within us. That's what it did. It aroused it. Paul used that word. I didn't. He said it brought sin out. The law brought sin out. Think about it. The law pointed out the sin in you. And once again, for the wages of sin is death. The payment for sin is death. You was on your way to hell because you couldn't keep the law. You couldn't keep the law. See, when we have an overwhelming tendency to do wrong for wrong's sake. I mean, we just do wrong. We have a sinful nature. We just do wrong just to do wrong. Ain't nobody got to teach us what wrong is. We're born with knowing how to do wrong. We're all tempted by the forbidden fruit. Whatever it is, we're all tempted by it. Often it's not the fruit itself that irresistibly draws us, but the fact that it's forbidden. Tell me don't do something, I'm going to want to do it anyway. Tell a child not to go outside and do this, or don't, they're going to want to know why. Why can't I do it? It's not the fact of what's in there. It's not the fact of what the thing is. It's just the fact that they want to know why they can't do it. When you tell somebody don't do this, is sometimes the only reason we're tempted to do it. God told Adam and Eve like this. He said, hey, y'all can have any tree, any fruit you want. Any fruit you want. But you see that tree right there? Don't touch that fruit. And guess what? Ooh, I wonder why. And that's, we're going to talk about it in a minute, but that's what Satan used to get Eve. Now, he done told you about all these other ones. Why didn't he tell you about this one? That's what it is. Why didn't he tell you about this one? Now, Eve is curious. That is. That's kind of interesting. He told me not to do this. I wonder why. What am I missing? Wow. The forbidden is a powerful magnet pulling on our sinful hearts. It's drawing you. The wrong thing always draws you to it. Why? Because deep inside, if we're honest, we absolutely despise someone telling us what to do, even if it's God. We see that in the church all the time. If somebody telling us what to do, we despise them. You can't tell me what to do. I know God for myself. I know Jesus for myself. I don't got to listen to you. I ain't got to do what you say do. Even when God himself tells you to do something, you have a problem with doing it. Why not, Lord? We no different. We are no different. It's actually come easy for us to sin. It's easy for us to sin. Because it's our nature to sin. It's in your DNA. It's who you are to sin. Yeah, it is. It's in your nature to sin. That's all you gotta do. Mm-hmm. It's easy. You wake up in the morning, you already sin. It's just like breathing. You breathing, you sin. It's a part of your chemical DNA of who you are. That's why you die to the old man and become alive in Christ. There's an old saying that a deacon used to say at St. Matthew's Missionary Baptist Church, 2412 Old Faith Street. Y'all know who the pastor is. None other than W.B. Armstrong. And there was a deacon Gant Harney. Man, that man could pray like no other. Man, Deacon Harney could pray. Here's the thing. Deacon Harney basically used to say, and he wouldn't say it all the time, just out of nowhere. He said, I died once, and I ain't got to die again. You know what he mean by that? He's basically saying is that I've died to my old man once. Now that I'm alive in Christ, I'm not gonna die anymore. Now, if I don't doubt myself, eventually I'll end up dying again. Yeah, that's what he was saying. I said this on Facebook the other day as a joke, but it makes a lot of sense though. I guarantee you, when Moses came down the mountain for the second time with a new set of 10 commandments, I guarantee you, somebody in the crowd said, Lord didn't tell me that. Here's this man as a spokesperson. Here's this man as the representative of God. And you ain't gonna listen to him because I need a burning bush. Like, everybody can't get a burning bush. Okay? Everybody can't get that one-on-one with God in that manner. And I guarantee you, when Moses came down off that mountain, so I guarantee you somebody said, well, he didn't tell me that. I didn't hear God say that. That's why they're so rebellious. Because God has given them rules. Don't do this, but do that. And what they do? They tested it. They just want to test it. See, we all know the truth of how we should live morally, and we intentionally do everything to suppress it. Man, you know the right thing to do. You just don't want to do it. You know before you the words come out of your mouth, you know that that is hurtful. You know that it's painful. You know that that's going to tear somebody down, and you do everything you can to keep that thought of you hurting somebody suppressed so you can say it and feel good about it. That's a shameless plug for Watch Our Bible Study series. If you in Bowling Green area, you can come by 12 or 6 p.m. on Wednesday on our virtual sanctuary at 6 p.m. on Thursdays. And you can actually hear about church hurt. But we do everything we can to not do the right thing. But it's easy for us to do the wrong thing. Here's a fact that it didn't make sense until I did a lot of research on it. Deacon Blakey, we are aroused by the law to transgress it. When we break the law, it turns us on. It makes us feel good when you do something wrong. It does. It really does. See, the former partnership with the law, we're going to talk about the arousal just one more time, just a little bit more. But the former partnership with the law, it rendered allegiance. You were bound by it. There was no other way. You better bring your sacrifice to this altar. We had a commitment to it. I mean, people brought animals from far away for the sacrifice. And it has a sensational appetite for it, and that which it stood for. There's a Bible verse in the Bible where they did sacrifices all day long, and the blood was just overflowing. Because you know what? Every time you sin, you can say, hey, just go get another ram. Kill it. I'll be okay. Hey, you did what? Y'all, get another goat, take it to the altar, UBI. That's how the law was treated. Yeah. And see, due diligence was given to upholding and carrying out the duties that aligned with the laws, even if they were based on flesh and sinful power. So basically what I'm saying is that the Pharisees added an addition to the law called the Mishnah. The Mishnah, it's right there on the screen, the Mishnah. And the Mishnah were additional teachings or sermons and sayings by Jewish rabbis meant to interpret the original Mosaic law. The Pharisees took pride on following not just the letter of the Mosaic law, but even the letter of the Mishnah as well. That's why Jesus said, you've heard this be said, but I say unto you. So this Mishnah was an addition to the 613 rules that God had already given. Imagine living that life. Imagine that way. The passions are shameful, have been tempered through the new unstemming from Jesus Christ's death. See, the flesh in itself is neither good nor bad, but can be used by the new person that has appropriated himself or herself to the death of Christ. Same agility and spirit embodiment was relegated to the old union. There is no salvation in the law. I just said a mouthful right there. So let me explain that to you. Do some compare and contrasting. That's all it's saying. And that's what Paul did when he looked at his old life compared to his new life. That's all he did. He looked at what he was doing in the old life versus what he was doing in this new life. That's all it is. Your old life is worthy to be talked about. I used to do this, but now that I'm dead to myself and I'm alive in Christ, I now do this. That's what it's saying. But see, there were 613 commands in the Old Testament, but the Pharisees created over 1,500 additional fits laws for the people to obey. They believed the best way to keep people from breaking God's law was to build a protective barrier around that law, even though the Lord never told them to do this. They said, you know what, God, we're going to help you out. I think I shared this with you before, is that you couldn't take a bath on the Sabbath. Because if you spilled some water and you cleaned it up, that was considered work. And we know that you're not supposed to work on the Sabbath. So that's a fence law. That's what was in this Mishnah. The people of Jesus' day were burdened down by man-made legalistic rules that God never commanded. What rules have been created in your life? What rules have been created in the church that God has never even ordained? I'll wait. Man, I need to get some jerky music in here. I'll wait. You can probably name 5-10 on top of your head. Yeah, we have added rules on top of rules. But because we died with Jesus at Calvary, we are dead to the law and delivered from its dominion over us as a principle of justification or of sanctification. We don't need the law to be right with God. We need grace. See, once again, faith is interesting because faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen, right? Yep, boom, gotcha. And here's the interesting thing. Faith without works is dead, but your works don't produce faith, but your faith should produce works. Got it? So I just gotta believe wholeheartedly Jesus Christ died for my sins and I'll be saved. Here's how you compare and contrast it with the law. See, with the goat, you can see your sins being forgiven because that was the rule of the law. So you bring a goat, slide it in his neck, and the blood drains out. You say, yup, I've been forgiven. Now it takes you, it takes faith now. At the same time, you got to offer a sacrifice in a pleasing, uniform way that it be a smelling, a nice aroma unto God, or he would have killed you. But, I mean, you can have a pen full of sheep that you just killed every single day because of your sins. But now this faith thing is something that can't be seen. You got to wholeheartedly believe it. The law doesn't justify us. It does not make us right with God. So I don't understand why people like to still try to hold you to the law. Why? It doesn't do anything for you. The law does not sanctify us. It does not take us deeper with God and make us more holy before Him. It does none of that. Our freedom is not given so we can stop serving God, but so that we can serve Him better. We've been freed from the law so we can be better servants under grace, under the newness of the Spirit, and not in the oldness of the letter. See, many people serve sin or legalism with more devotion than those who should serve God out of newness of the Spirit. We got some people in the church, y'all, that were just so legalistic, and they are wholeheartedly legalistic. Wholehearted. Wholeheartedly legalistic. And if the Bible doesn't say this, then we don't do it. Yeah, we got to do that. Then at the end of the day, though, you know, serving because of what Christ did, they don't want to do that. Don't do that at all. It is unfortunate that we fear, that when fear motivates us more than love. You know, a lot of people give their life to Christ. In the old days, because all the preacher would preach about was fire and brimstone and going to hell. And nobody wants to go to hell. So guess what? I'm just going to give my life to Christ. Because I don't want to go to hell. How about because of God's love for you, you do what he say do? You follow him. Because of what God has done for you, you do what is right. Can we do that? So this is what Paul says in the closing verses. He says, what shall we say then? Is the law sinful? No. Nevertheless, here's what the purpose of the law is. Paul says, I would not have known what sin was had it not been for the law. For I would not have known what coveting or covetousness or wanting something that belongs to somebody else that's not yours was the law had I said, you shouldn't covet. I wouldn't have known what it was. I've been walking around out here doing it. I had no idea what it was, but now, because the law said you shouldn't do it, I was like, oh, that's what I was doing. But sin sees an opportunity afforded by the commandment produced in me every kind of covetousness. So now you know you shouldn't speed, so you're going to speed anyway. You know good well you're in the construction zone on I-65, and you know that speed limit is 45 to 55 miles an hour. But because you know what the law says, you do it anyway. This is what Paul meant about that arousal. It makes you want to do it anymore. But you wouldn't know you were doing something wrong had the speaking limit never been posted. You wouldn't have known you were doing something wrong. You've just been going out here just doing it. For apart from the law, sin was dead. Sin wasn't alive in me because I didn't know it was wrong. See, that's why you can't get mad at people who don't know what they're doing wrong. Now it's our job to teach people, but you can't get mad at people because they don't know what's wrong. You can't get mad at people for not knowing what they don't know. But once I was alive apart from the law, but when the commandment came, sin sprang to life and I died. Now I'm on the track to hell. Sin is running through me now. So what Paul is saying is, hey, when I was driving on I-65 and I go through a construction zone, I see the yellow, the orange sign that says 55 miles an hour. And now that I know that going anything above 55 miles per hour is a breaking the law, I now go 75 miles an hour. I now have put my life and other people's life at risk of dying. That's what he's saying. That's the best way I can explain it to you. He said, for sin seizing the opportunity afforded by the commandment deceived me. I'll be all right. I mean, you don't see a state police or a state trooper, so I can do this. I'll be okay. Yep. I mean, it deceived me. You can have it ain't raining outside. The weather ain't bad. I mean, after all, I mean, at the end of the day, there's no other cars out here. Do you know you got a single vehicle crash? I know a good friend of mine in the Army that died. Yep. Come on. No, it was dry outside. It was everything. The weather was nice and sunny, and she had a rollover accident and died. So then the law is holy, and the commandment is holy, righteous, and good. Paul's discourse, his dissertation to a people that enjoyed, like, relish, that savored the law, probably came across as harsh. He's literally telling the Jews, the law ain't done nothing for you. He's been telling them, you ain't got to follow the law. And many of his comments seem to disparage, belittle, sneer the law, whatever. Yeah, you ain't got to do it. You ain't got to follow the law. 613, you ain't got to do it. And the 1,500 that was added, you ain't got to do it either. That's basically where they took it, what Paul was saying. Paul said, okay, let me explain this to y'all. Is the law equal to sin? He says, okay. No, y'all, that's not what I'm saying. I'm not saying to follow the law is sinful. But through the law, he came to know sin. Through the traffic handbook to get your driver's license, you came to know the driving rules and regulations in the state of Kentucky, state of Tennessee. It reveals sin and it incites sin. It makes you want to sin. Now, you know you're supposed to go 45 miles an hour. You know you're supposed to go 15 miles an hour in the school zone. How many of y'all be like, 20 will be okay? You know you're supposed to do that. And you don't do it anymore. That's what sin do. That's what the law, the law is saying. Hey, Reggie, you know that the law says this. You know God don't like you doing that. He don't. Mm-mm. I didn't know that. Now that I know that, let me intentionally not do it. That's how we think. That's how we act. Mm-hmm. So God uses the law in a twofold manner to awaken us. First, it serves as to awaken our consciousness by revealing the sinfulness of the flesh. Now, a lot of people don't want to read the Bible because they don't want to be known what's right or wrong. Paul insists that we must die to the law if we would bear fruit to God. You got to let that law go. Pharisee, we got a lot of Pharisees in the pews today, in the church, let it go. You see, like this, the law is like an x-ray machine. It reveals what is there, but hidden. If my arm was fractured right now, you can't see that my arm is fractured, but an x-ray machine could. I wouldn't even know it was fractured, but an x-ray machine would. Here's the fact of the matter. You can't blame the x-ray machine for what it exposes. You can't get mad at the law because of what it exposes. If I went to the doctor right now and he took an x-ray of my arm and his shoulder, it's fractured, and I didn't know, now I'm mad. That ain't got nothing. You get mad at the wrong, get mad at yourself. That's what you gotta do. Get mad at yourself. See, the law sets the speed limit so we know exactly if we are going too fast. We might never know that we are sinning in many areas, such as covetousness, if the law doesn't show us the sin. You don't know if you're speeding until the speed limit signs show up. You don't know you're speeding until the blue lights are behind you. God says it like this. I'm gonna show you what you're doing wrong so you know that you're doing it wrong. But it's kind of like we do the complete opposite. God has to show us what we're doing wrong so we'll stop doing it and we do it even more. But sin, taking opportunity by the commandment, produces in me all manner of evil desire. For apart from the law, sin was dead. When I wasn't under the law, when I didn't know what the law said, sin, there was no sin in it. So basically it's like when people say, don't do that, saying don't do that is like saying, go do it. Because of our sinful, rebellious hearts. It isn't the fault of the commandment, but it is our fault. The law just pointed out what we're doing wrong. We gotta make a choice on do we fix it or not. And see, once God draws a boundary for us, we are immediately enticed to cross that boundary soon as God said, don't do that, guess what? We want to do it anyway. God said, don't worship no other gods but Him. Let me find out what happens if I do. Yeah. That's who we are. Galatians 5 is a war between us. Yeah. We are enticed to cross that boundary, which is no fault of God or His boundary, but the fault of our sinful hearts. It's you the problem. God, the law is good. It serves its purpose to point out what you're doing wrong. You just don't want to do what's right. You can't do what's right because of your sinful heart. Give you an example. 1965, I believe, 65, 67. The United States decided to attack Fidel Castro's communist regime in Cuba. You wanna know what they did? They banned many items, imports. You can't bring stuff from Cuba to the United States. And guess what was on that list? A cigar. If the authorities caught you trying to smuggle a Cuban into the United States, you will have to pay a fine and go up to about $55,000 for this right here, y'all. For this cigar right here. If you brought this into the United States, you could be fined up to $55,000. And because it was said that it was no good, you couldn't do it. Guess what that made people do? Do it anyway. They tried to do it anyway. Nevertheless, the ban on Cuban cigars amplified the appeal and desire for Cuban products and made people crave for the taste of Cuban soil. Yes. In the form of a cigar. It made people fight for these. It made people risk their lives. They went overboard just to get this. And if you were successful at getting it over, guess what? You raise the price. A Cuban cigar is no different than any other cigar, y'all. It just happened to have a Cuban soil and Cuban seed from a Cuban tobacco plant. I smoked several cigars, and a Cuban cigar is no different than any other cigar, but because he was told not to bring it, not to have it, now you're at a point where it makes it that much more enticing. That's why people say, I want to smoke Cubans. When people tell me that, I'm like, you don't even know what you're doing. You don't even know what this thing is really about. You're not a cigar aficionado. You just saying you smoke Cubans because it's higher in price, but it's the risk. Now you can bring Cubans up to $100 worth in the United States. But back then, But because you was told don't do it, it made people want to do it. It's like the Prohibition Act. It didn't stop alcohol. It made it enticing to bootleg alcohol because the government say don't do it. Operating in the law, Paul felt guilty about sin only because he was made aware through the law of what sin was. The longing for that which is evil becomes apparent when the commandment declares that something is forbidden. Then the sinner wants it. You can't smoke cigars, Kortney. That makes you want one even more. In essence, God uses the law to reveal the sinfulness of your flesh. The law makes people realize that. Don't follow it, but it should bring out that, hey, something's wrong here. And it should point that I am a sinner destined to die. But it offers no hope. Because why? The law cannot save you. But grace can. Many of the laws were also punishable by physical death. Sin is real and it is dangerous. It would entice you into the deep and then it would drown you. How do you put it this way? It thrives on an opportunity to interact with the law in order to sneak upon you and reveal its hand. Sin is evil and acts as the primary cause, while the commandment itself is the secondary cause of why the unsuspecting target falls victim to the violation. Humanity has a compensatory will by human nature to do that which is forbidden. It's your sin nature. The law, with this prohibition, incites sin, and without the law, sin is dead. The weakness of the law isn't in the law, it's in us. The law is good. The law did what it was supposed to do. The Embargo Act did what it was supposed to do. It punished Fidel Castro, and it put an economic strain on Cuba because of their communism. But guess what? People didn't care about that. They were looking at the fact that I want something that you say I can't have. And that's a Cuban cigar. And that's how it begins. See, sin can take something good and holy like the law and twist it to promote evil. Sin warps love into lust, an honored desire to provide for one's family into greed, and the law into a promoter of sin. If someone's stealing from the church, they don't start off real big. They usually start off with, I'm going to take this $100 and I'm going to put it back next week. And then next week come and they take another $100 and say, well, I'll pay back $200. Next thing you know, they have embezzled so much more, they just can't even really begin to pay it back. They don't start off with just a little bit. I mean, with a whole lot, it starts with a little bit. See, children can be innocent before they know or understand what the law requires. They're innocent. They don't know these things until you tell them, don't do that. It's like church folks. Tell them don't do it, they'll do it even more. Tell them I want you all in the same suit, same shirt, same tie. Watch somebody, don't do it. Tell them I all want you here to do this, to be here, to be active, and watch somebody won't do it. And this is what Paul refers to when he said, I was alive once without the law. Because I didn't know what was wrong. So sin, I didn't know I was sinning, so there's no death to come from that. He is not alive with the life that the New Testament writers so often speak about. He is alive in the sense that he has never been put to death as a result of the confrontation with the law. He never had to look at the law and say, this is what I was doing. That's why he could go from church to church, house to house, city to city, and arrest people and bring them back to Jerusalem to face death for being a Christian. He hadn't been, but until God himself showed up and said, Paul, why are you persecuting me? Then Paul was like, oh my God. That's why you should focus on yourself and not everybody else. See, we do not come to know the law. The law shows us our guilt and it excites our rebellion, bringing forth more sin and death. So when you go and you start flipping in that room, that's what the Bible is supposed to do, confront you. That's what it's supposed to do, confront you. And the commandment, which was to bring life, he said, I found to bring death. And sin does this by deception. See, this is how sin deceives us. Because sin falsely promises satisfaction. That's number one. Tell you something, you're going to feel good about doing this. Because sin falsely claims an adequate excuse. I'm just a sinner. I was born this way. It's what I'm supposed to do. I'm not Jesus. I don't have to do it. That's basically what it's saying. That's what sin will tell you to say. Because I'm not Jesus, I don't have to do what Jesus did. And then here's how sin deceives us. Because sin falsely promises an escape from punishment. It's a little white lie. Ain't nobody gonna know about it. It's okay to lie. How many of y'all have parents that will tell you when you answer the phone, that will be like, tell them I'm not here. Escape from punishment. See, it isn't the law that deceives us, but it's a sin that uses the law as an occasion for rebellion. This is why Jesus said, you shall know the truth, and the truth shall set you free. The truth makes us free from the deceptions of sin. Sin, when followed, leads us to death, not life. And one of Satan's greatest deceptions is to get us to think of sin as something good that an unpleasant God wants to deprive us of. That's what Satan, like, God, that's how he got Eve. Oh, God told you not to eat that because you'll become just like him. Now Eve is like, well, shoot, I want to become just like God. Let me eat this. Adam, you need to eat this too. It looks so good. Yeah. And then Satan said, gotcha. See, when God warns us away from sin, he warns us from something that will kill us. That was the whole point of it. Something that will kill us. So the law reveals sin to us. And that's why Hebrews 12:1 says, tell us to lay aside every weight, every burden that so easily holds us down. The law will hold us down, burdensome, because we like to sin, and the law keeps putting burdens and pressure on us to do right, and we can't do it. Now, the law is good, has works rather than faith as a focus. It is a yoke that inhibits our ability to run the race with patience. When you keep putting people under the law, before the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus, all of us were bound by sin with no hope of it. We couldn't keep the law, and even today, we still can't keep the law. That's why we put our faith in the one who can keep the law and who didn't keep the law. Jesus purchased our salvation and freedom with compassionate love and enduring grace, shedding his blood on the cross. We are now free from the penalty of sin and the weight of the law when you accept Jesus Christ. This freedom is not an endorsement to do wrong, but a call to serve God through faith and not works alone. You serve God through faith now because you're like, I believe that Jesus died on the cross. I wasn't there, but I believe he did. And I believe his completed work on the cross sealed my salvation with God. You wasn't there that Friday. You sure wasn't. But you got to put faith that it did. What if we have the privilege of living as Jesus will have us live. That's all the time we have for today. Stay tuned. In the next 30 minutes will be our morning worship with the day sermon entitled For Thine the Glory. This is really heavy. This is really deep. It really is. But understand that you don't have to keep the law anymore because we put our faith in the one who did. So we don't have to do it anymore. And that we can actually use the law to show us what we've done wrong. But we also put our faith in Jesus that his blood paid for what we did wrong. So therefore, guess what? We no longer have to be bound by the law. We are free to live for Jesus and not under the law. Hey, my name is Pastor K. I want to thank you so much for this Sunday morning conversation. Once again, stay around the next 30 minutes is your morning worship. May God bless you. May He keep you. Let us pray. Lord, we love you. We praise you. We bless your holy name. We want to thank you, Lord, for everything you have done, Lord. You are amazing. For something that we couldn't do, you did it for us. We love you and we praise you. We bless your holy name. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. God bless you.